Welcome to the Sarah Show. This is a show for just people in general who want to be inspired by some incredible stories. I travel coast to coast, north to south, east to west, and I meet so many incredible people that I just had to bring them to you. And today I am here with Prasha Dutra. Thank you for taking some time out this evening to chat with me and my audience. How are you today?
Of course. Thank you so much for having me. I'm great. And I absolutely love launches. So it's so great to be on the first episode. So this is awesome.
Thank you.
I love it.
My official, I mean, I've been doing this forever. I said when I graduated, I wanted to be the next Katie Couric. And I said, but I don't want to be famous. But I guess I have this little slice of Instagram fame. Not Instagram, but internet fame. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yes.
Yikes. I got to eat dinner before these, I think. Going down.
Yes, definitely.
So your accent, although you're from New England, you live in Rhode Island, you don't have a New England accent, right?
Yes, because I moved from India here about 6 years ago. So
it blows my mind.
American accent.
Yeah, I can't even imagine. I mean, I once studied abroad. I studied in London because they spoke English. And the 3.5-4 months I was there, I felt like I never really even assimilated into the culture that isn't even that different. I mean, that alone, I mean, so you live in Rhode Island, and then you are in the top 7%, or so you are the one of 7% in your industry because you're a woman in your industry. Right?
Correct. So the statistics say that there are about 7% mechanical engineering women in America around that. That's around 2016. So that's the statistics. But yes, I belong to that group of little tiny group of women in mechanical engineers.
So you've overcome all of these different things. I mean, that's so crazy. So, I mean, it's like you're in the, I think you're like in the 0.00001%, like the pinnacle of just everything that you've done. Mm-hmm. That's so, okay. So because your business is Her STEM Story, and that's where everyone can find you, right? You have a podcast, you have a blog, a website, that's where you are on Facebook. And so I got it wrong in my first post, but so let's do it again. So science, technology, engineering and mathematics.
Correct. Yes. Yes.
So being in healthcare, am I also in science or what does science mean?
So a lot of people don't realize that they are in support functions for STEM because, you know, we can't have STEM by itself. So the idea of using that word STEM is to show that they're all together. So I can't have science without, you know, technology or engineering or mathematics and so on and so forth. And if you're associated with any kind of, you know, science or biology or, you know, any kind of those fields, you're essentially a part of STEM. Doesn't matter what your degree is. And that's what our podcast is about. You know, we talk to a lot of women who have arts degrees or who support science communication or who are just in, you know, leadership coaching roles for women in STEM in general. So those are the stories where I want people to know that you necessarily don't have to like math or you don't have to be, you know, genius or I definitely for once am not a genius. So, I mean, a lot of people get scared or overwhelmed that it's just too difficult. Whereas it's just like any other course that you take, you just have to take enough classes and, you know, be interested in it. So that's what STEM is.
Is it the same in India where women don't tend to go into the field or is it just like that here in the States?
No, it's a little different because in India, engineering is really popular and so is medicine. So if you're going to, a good school or English medium school, the tendency of the parents is to push kids because they pay for you till the end of your college. So they want you to do good. We don't have like college college jobs and stuff. So we don't do part-time jobs. So that's why they care where their money goes. So it's very important to them. So I guess the push is more there. So, but still when we only had a handful of girls in engineering classes, so it's still less, even in India.
I mean, you got a lot here. You have, you know, you're just kicking butt because in the 3 months that you've been a podcaster, you've managed to nail down 20 interviews.
Yes.
And you work full time, right?
Yes.
this. And so mm-hmm. how do you keep yourself motivated? How do you eat your excuses for breakfast?
So I think number one is my cousin, who's 14 years old. When she was here last year, I was trying to motivate her to take STEM, and she was so bored of it. She's like, no, don't tell me this story again. So that's one of the reasons I started the podcast, to make sure that she knows that there are other girls who are as cool as the next Instagram star. They're as, you know, traveled as the next, you know, big traveler that they follow on online, or they're as accomplished as, you know, anyone else, and they still manage to have a great life. And I wanted her to see that. And she's my number one inspiration. And after that, I think I'm surrounded by so many amazing women in STEM, or women who are just, as you said, you know, they're doing amazing. I really wonder, nobody's talking to us, like, what, you know, we are here, even if it's 7%, for me, it's a lot, because, you know, I have colleagues and I have, you know, classmates that, interestingly, all my bridesmaids were engineers, because that's how I know them, from engineering.
Yeah, right.
So that's my, you know, I really want people to see that, you know, we're just like normal people, and we're not, you know, oddities or weird geeks, or just literally normal people with normal jobs, but extraordinary stories, because we've overcome a lot of, you know, challenges, and it's not easy for anyone. So to share all that is, you know, what keeps me motivated to do it.
Yeah. No, I mean, that's amazing. And I've seen the same thing in healthcare. I mean, there are different challenges, I think, to being a woman, because, I was like running, I kept you waiting. I usually like to hang out in the green room before I come live with my interviews. And my son, he just wanted to be held by his mama for 2 hours straight this afternoon. And, you know, he didn't want his dad. His dad couldn't give him the same thing that I have. Mm-hmm. And so there are some things that only women can do.
Like, yes.
Have the babies. Breastfeed the babies, you know, and I want my mom at so many different times, and don't want my dad. And so, you know, it's juggling that. And I felt the same way when I was in college. I remember, mm-hmm. even though being in communications, I remember it got to a certain level where everyone that they would bring in was mm-hmm. male. It was all male dominated when it got to a certain mm-hmm. level. And I remember raising my hand once and saying, like, well, how did you do it? How did you? I remember, I think, talking to like a CEO of Amazon, and this was back in 2005. Amazon was barely anything at that mm-hmm. time. And asking, like, how do you juggle work-life mm-hmm. balance? And he didn't really give me a great answer. Mm-hmm. Going into sales, all the sales managers, mm-hmm. VPs of sales and above, I personally didn't have anyone who was a woman that I said, I want to be just like her, that had mm-hmm. everything that I had. Mm-hmm. The only female manager that I had that I truly looked up to was single. So it was tough. And so I'm so grateful, because I'm mm-hmm. trying to do the same thing even in healthcare and create mm-hmm. Women's practitioner groups, because I find I attract a lot of women. I was just earlier this afternoon on a call with someone and said, yeah, how can I do this? How can I create a practice and do it and possibly mm-hmm. even be from home? And the people that I talk to are grateful for the people like you. I have to say, Prasha, because you are the engineering and the technology and the science, right? Behind these three tools, like the internet, Facebook Live.
Definitely.
Uh-huh. Keep doing that for sure.
Thank you so much.
Being a modern day superhero, you know, hasn't really always been the title that you've had, right? So growing up, you're pretty open about your battle with some of your mental health challenges, teenager, and then, mm-hmm. you know, as a young adult. So would you mind sharing a part of that story with us?
Oh, yeah, oh, definitely. Because I feel strongly about it. Because when I was, I didn't have a lot of support or stories to look up to. Same way that we just said about STEM stories. But I had, you know, two extreme depression episodes, one right after high school while I was trying to get into college. And in India, it's a very, very difficult competition to get through, like entrance exams. So you have to take a gap year. And that was usually like the year where you feel like a loser, obviously, because, you know, everyone's going to college and you're waiting here trying to give this exam, which, by the way, out of 10 million people, only 8,000 make it. I mean, wow. That's how crazy it is. It's just outrageous how bad, how crazy it is.
You're basically like a NFL player or something.
Yeah, something like that. And you're preparing for it, and you know, your parents really want you to do it because they think, you know, that's the best way for you, like the easiest way or the fastest way to become successful. In India, when you have so much population, you really have to be, you know, beat the competition. But at that time, you know, we didn't have anyone telling us that, you know, it's okay to be sad. It's okay to be feel scared or, you know, there was nothing like mental health. Like nobody talked about it, you know. So that was one episode. And the second episode I had was after I lost my father 3 years ago to pancreatic cancer. And that's why I'm wearing the pin to Pancreatic Cancer Action Network. But when I lost him, I was alone in Rhode Island. I just moved here. So I had no one, no family. And I had a visa process, so I couldn't go back home. So I had to be here by myself. And at that time, I didn't know my husband. So I had absolutely no friends. I recently moved here. So it was a very, very tough time. But those two episodes completely changed not just the course of my life, but also the course of, you know, how I take care of myself or how I, you know, deal with stress or even like challenges. So the first time that it happened, I think my curiosity or the drive in me to look for challenges helped me a lot to overcome it. So I would look for, you know, challenges at school. And my dad used to say that you should always be different, like never be like others. So it was never a question. So if everyone was going left, I would go right. So I was so driven by that I just don't want to be like others. So I would always look for like the most difficult challenge or competition or just, you know, paper, a poster competition or something. And one thing led to another. And I participated in international competitions in school. And that kind of took my mind away from, you know, the depressing part of it, even though both times I was not diagnosed with clinical depression. But that makes it even harder. Now, you know, you really don't even have any medication or anything to tell you that something's wrong with you or something's right with you. So that time, that's how I got out of it. With years, I mean, obviously it takes a lot of time. First, you have to come to terms with it and say, okay, it's okay. You know, it's okay to feel low, but, you know, you got to look for that next challenge. And that's what I encourage others to do too, that, you know, you just have to challenge yourself because that way all your senses are now invested in that challenge. And it's easier to look for, you know, the better in life.
Yeah. That's interesting that you even say that all your senses. Have you read the 5-second rule?
I have. Yeah. I'm a huge fan of Mel
just
Robbins.
Trick yourself, right?
Yes, definitely.
And that's exactly what she says. It's taking your brain away from it. And I mean, if I was picking a dodgeball team, you would be my first pick. You're like, yes, I'm going to take that challenge on. And yes. And sometimes, you know, you wonder, you have to struggle sometimes to kind of break through. They say like break down to break through. And you know, you don't know what it means at the time, but it's almost like, thank you for going through that because you can help so many other people because of your experience.
Mm-hmm. And there's nothing to, you know, be ashamed of it or be like, oh my God, I'm not perfect. And that's fine. I mean, people who say they're perfect are not perfect either. So, I mean, it's just a lie anyway. So the second time it happened was when I lost my father. I think a couple of things that, because I promised everyone that I'll share some tips, that's why I'll share some tips. Of course, I would not say that you should deny medication. I personally don't believe in it. Secondly, I was not diagnosed with clinical depression because when I went to the doctors, at work, we had to do it. Like, I really had to go get tested for clinical depression, and I did. And when you don't get diagnosed, it's a good thing and a bad thing, but it definitely keeps you away from medication. But I think the three things that, you know, anyone can do if they're going through anxiety attacks or, you know, depressing phases in life, you know, depression doesn't mean that you're broken. It just means it's a phase. It's going to get over and you'll be fine. But you can't look at it as, you know, it's not like it's permanent, right? No, but nothing is permanent. But three things that really helped me were, number one is, you know, you have to be very curious. As I said, you really have to look for that challenge. You have to look outside your mind and look for that next challenge or be curious. And that's why I use my STEM story to say that, because science and my background or my education helped me, you know, because I was independent and I was able to, you know, pay my bills and I was able to, you know, go to work every day. I was grateful for those things. And those helped me recover, obviously, with, you know, because imagine if you have all that going on versus also not having money to pay your bills. So it just makes it really, really worse. I think my education definitely helped me, you know, with that. Second thing is meditate. I love meditation. And I this app has not paid me any money to say this, but Calm
is
the best app ever. Tamara Levitt has literally saved my life so many times because of her voice. I could fall asleep. I am so much more, you know, contained, and I don't get caught up in the waves of life per se. You know, I can really sit back and relax sometimes. And then finally is hiking. I absolutely enjoy hiking. I think it's the best mental exercise outside. Just step outside and, you know, don't even go on a mountain. Just go on a trail and you will be surprised how good you feel. So if you're anxious or you're just, you know, can't keep calm, then, you know, just leave the door, leave the room, go take a walk. It'll make you feel really, really good.
That's really interesting that you say that, because a lot of the practitioners that I work with, there's and this is so timely that we're airing this in April, because I hope that our interview will catch some steam next month, being Mental Health Awareness Month. Mm-hmm. So we're just right ahead of it. And a lot of my practitioners, when we talk about mental health, the new thing is the brain-gut connection. And where it really even starts in the stomach. And the interesting thing that they're finding about our stomachs is the fact that we sanitize our entire lives. And they even banned the type of sanitizer, antibacterial, I forget the name of it now, that was in hand soap, because they were finding it was actually creating super bugs. And so they took that back and said, wait, that wasn't so good. But we still are like too clean sometimes. And so a lot of doctors now are saying, as part of their prescription, is to get outside, because it's actually going to change your microbiome. And so if we can change the microbiome, right? And then if that's connected to the brain, we're just going to be healthier. So, I mean, I think for sure, just to get outside, like breathe some fresh air, get somewhere different. But from a biological standpoint as well, bring on a practitioner to
see if definitely connection. And I know people, you know, obviously everyone will be like, I know working out helps, but not everyone is into working out, and it's a difficult thing to get into, you know, to get used to. It takes almost, you know, years to make it a habit, but as compared to hiking, because or just, you know, going on a trail, because that's not that big of a task. It's not like someone's asking you to like lift weight or go running. You really don't have to go to the extreme of it. But just walking every day is such a great, great healer, or, you know, just something that calms your nerves down for sure. So because I lived alone and I had no option, like I really had to get out, and getting out was so helpful that I would do it every day. And it just makes you feel much better and more concentrated.
I would imagine being in the industry you're in also, it's probably a lot of computers in most of those, you know, most of those industries. And if you're not getting outside or not even getting in all your steps, right? That's also so important.
For sure.
Do you have a wearable device? Do you wear?
I have iWatch, but I never get it charged. Like I always forget to charge it. That's the worst problem.
My husband's always finding my watch and putting it somewhere on the charger. Yes. So I'm sure that's where it is right now.
Yes.
So my last question for you, I mean, I'm a mom of a 4-year-old daughter, and how do I inspire her? Because we have a lot of Barbies and dollies and princesses, and she actually says that she wants to be a doctor when she grows up, because my dad's a doctor, her grandfather, and it's been really fun for her to see him in a lab coat. But how do I get her excited about a STEM career, and what excited you?
So when I was a kid, it was obviously never sold to us as STEM, you know, it was just sold to us as a great career. But when we were kids, my dad was an absolute fan of Discovery Channel. So growing up, that's all we watched. Like he would, like every other parent was getting rid of the TV so that kids could study, but he would call us out at like 10 p.m. like, oh my God, you know, Shark Week is on, or, you know, this is on or that's on. How How Do They Do It? How It's Made. That's the show. Yes. And that was the show that told, like, I really wanted to work in a factory. Like, that's all I ever wanted. And I work in a factory. I work in a factory in Lincoln. I'm a quality manager for them. So I'd spend a lot of time on the floor. And it's absolutely amazing that, you know, we were so far away from America, but we had Discovery Channel. And, you know, it was in Hindi. They would dub it so you could understand. It was awesome. But that's something that got us interested, you know, from a very young age. But also nowadays in America, you have all these STEM toys. I mean, I'm sure you could, you know, get Goldie Blocks. And I know they're, it's called Goldie Blocks. And then, which is the other one? I can't remember. But there are tons of STEM toys that you could find online. And they're like, as you know, they're really cute. Oh, actually, there was one called the Lip Balm Lab, I think it's called. Ooh. So you can make your own lip balm. And actually, when she grows up a little bit, you could take her to D.C. for the annual Science and Engineering Festival that was happening this last weekend. And it was pretty cool what I saw online. And, you know, it's really good to expose them. In the end, it's their choice. But for them to know that, you know, it's not something that you can't do. The other thing we did was I interviewed a lady who wrote a book called STEM Gems. And she has put together a book of, you know, 44 women role models in a very, very, very kids appealing, you know, format. And that's something when she gets old enough to read, maybe that's the book you should get her for Christmas.
I mean, I just like thank people like you that are such inspiring, especially as women who are, you know, young, up and coming, and are going to be a role model for my daughter. And hopefully for my son too. I mean, I think that, I mean, what you're talking about with mental health and with being inspired and all that great pressure and the way that you approach challenges. I mean, these are universal topics that we all need to be reminded of, because it might come at a young age. It might come at an older age, you know, that you're feeling like, you know, I want to do something different, but this seems insurmountable. I mean, you were one of 8,000 out of 10 million.
I didn't get selected though.
Just to try to do that. Like, it's incredible to think about, but I mean, then you're here and you immigrated here and you are working in the fields that you set out to work. And, incredible odds that you came across to be able to be here. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I hope people follow you at Her STEM Story. I hope that it comes, it keeps blossoming as a community for you, and especially with the podcast.
Yes.
I cannot wait to meet you. And now that I know that you hike, I don't think I'm very outdoorsy, so I would love to meet you. We'll have to go on a little hike. And,
yes, definitely.
I'll introduce you to some of my friends, and you'll have to do the same. And anything else you want to leave our audience with before we say goodbye?
No, and I think you did it. You said a very good thing in the end that we really need to expose our sons to women in leadership, and for them to be okay with it, you know, for them to be the champions for the women that they will be surrounded by, or girls that they will be surrounded by in school and college. And that's just a value that you inculcate at a really young age. And that's the solution. I think that's the actual solution to the whole gender gap and gender, you know, inequality or gender pay. Actually, today is Equal Pay Day. Which means women should be paid equally. And I think that's a great point you brought there, that I think even in our world of, you know, women in STEM, where I'm concentrating only on women, I lose that perspective that, you know, we really have to include men as well. They're an equal part of this dialogue, and they need to see us as accomplished, and they need to not be afraid of us, or not be, you know, say that, you know, not be intimidated. But that's a value that you teach when they're kids, and that these are the role models, and it's okay to be, you know, it's okay to achieve everything and then still be a mother.
And the men should have female role models and the women should have male role models, right?
Yes, definitely. That would be the ideal world. but in the end, just, you know, check out our website at www.herstemstory.com. And our podcast is available on iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and also on the website. So I would you know, leave a link in the comment for whoever's interested in joining. And then obviously I can't wait to see you as well.
Yes, I can't wait to meet you.
Yes, all right.
Prasha, thank you so much for being such a superstar in your arena. And I will see you soon, girlfriend.
Thank you, Sarah. Congratulations on your first episode.
Thanks for being great. Talk to you soon.
Bye.